Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I would like now to begin with my presentation. My name is Anna Lipska and I'm administrator, lawyer, working for the General Secretariat of the Council of the European Union in the directorate dealing with the judicial cooperation in criminal matters. My presentation will deal with the collection of evidence across the member states of the European Union. Now, to start with, I would like to indicate to you that generally for the judicial authorities there are two requirements they are mostly keen on when it comes to gathering of evidence. That is, to have the evidence on time and to have this evidence in a form which could be useful for them for their proceedings. Now, within the EU we are facing a situation where the judicial authorities have to deal with cases of crime happening throughout across the borders of the EU member states. So the cases become much more complicated and thus the issues linked in particular to the collection of evidence are not as evident as they used to be. To address that point, a number of developments has recently taken place within the EU, both on legislative level with a number of instruments adopted by the legislative bodies of the EU and on the operational level, that is mainly the establishment of the Eurojust as well as setting up of the joint investigation teams. In this presentation, which will be divided in three parts, I would like to address these particular issues, not only from the perspective of the developments which have taken place within the EU, but also to arrive at the very end with some more detailed information as to the ongoing legislative work of the Council. Now, to structure this presentation, I have divided it into three parts. In the first part, I will present to you the background of instruments linked to the gathering of evidence across the European Union. Secondly, I will talk a little bit about the coexistence of mutual legal assistance and mutual recognition instruments. And eventually, in the third part, I will go into more detail concerning the two major instruments we have within the EU, that is the European Evidence Warrant and European Investigation Order. So let me now start with part one. Now, the traditional judicial cooperation, which is based on mutual legal assistance, implies that any sovereign state, competent authority of that state, may file a request to any sovereign state, any other sovereign state, asking it to undertake a specific investigative measure. That later state will then independently decide whether to enforce, to give action to that request. On this assumption are based the two main instruments of mutual legal assistance, which the practitioners across the EU are currently applying. That is the 1959 Convention of Council of Europe, as well as 2000 Convention, EU Convention on Mutual Legal Assistance. The system based on mutual legal assistance principle is not a bad system. It actually allows for a rather extensive flexibility where it comes to contact between the member states. It also encompasses a rather broad scope of any action that could be requested by one authority to another. However, it also has its significant weaknesses, and that being the main criticism being that the system is perceived as rather complex and slow. Complexity of the system comes from the fact that requests are usually made through the competent authorities at the central level, that is, from ministries to ministries. That would also imply a certain and sometimes rather significant delays when it comes to the execution of the requests. Secondly, we can see throughout the member states which participate to certain conventions differences in the extent to which certain provisions might be applicable. That is, due to the fact that many of the conventions allow for notifications or declarations being made to specific provisions, the full picture of application of these provisions would differ from one country to another. All that, of course, doesn't render the work of practitioners particularly easy. This criticism of the mutual legal assistance, at the same time the recognition of its advantages, has led at the EU level to rather extensive reflection, trying to find out solutions which could provide for a better instruments, for a better tools for practitioners to gather evidence across the borders. And so as early as in 1999, with the Tampere Council conclusions, it has been indicated that the principle of mutual recognition, so far known for the internal market operation, should become also applicable to the cooperation between the judicial authorities of the member states. It has been commonly known as becoming a cornerstone of cooperation in civil and criminal matters. And furthermore, it has been indicated that that principle should become applicable in particular to the gathering of evidence in cross-border cases. Now, the free circulation of judicial decisions seems to naturally match the free circulation of free movement of people, as well as that would imply the free circulation of criminals and criminal activities throughout the European Union. And that is exactly where the principle of mutual recognition makes a difference to the concept of judicial cooperation among the competent authorities of the member states. What does this imply in practice? Well, de facto, as against the application of the mutual legal assistance, when it comes to the mutual recognition, any competent authority of any member state should ipso facto recognize and execute the request which is filed to it by any other competent authority in any other member state, and that without any additional formalities or any additional requirements. So the request is being dealt with as if it has been made in a purely national case. In the context of the European Union's legislative activity, so far two instruments have been adopted to implement this principle, the principle of mutual recognition, to the gathering of evidence across the borders. The first of these instruments is the Framework Decision of 2003 on freezing of the so-called Framework Decision of freezing of assets. The second of these instruments is the 2008 Framework Decision on European Evidence Warrant. The two Framework Decisions which I have just mentioned come into play as against the background of the Mutual Legal Assistance Instruments, the Council of Europe Convention of 1959 and the 2000 EU MLA Convention. All that may lead us to a conclusion that the practitioners among the EU member states are facing a rather complex and fragmented system of sometimes double applicability of instruments as against a specific gathering of evidence. The main difference between the mutual legal assistance and mutual recognition is that the mutual legal assistance may be used to request any measure in any member state to be undertaken by its competent authorities. At the same time, the mutual recognition may only be used to request specific measures which have been regulated by the EU instruments in that respect. And so the two systems are not entirely complementary. This multitude of available instruments and their coexistence makes indeed the life of practitioners rather difficult. They will need to choose which of the instruments to apply and sometimes will need to use both of the possibilities offered by them by these legislative acts in order to gather completely the required evidence. Now, the criticism of this particularity of the current state of play within the EU concerning the gathering of evidence have been put forward to the Council for its reflection. The Stockholm Programme, which was adopted in December 2009, have pointed out to that particular issue and urged the Commission or the Member State to work in the future on legislative instruments which would put an end to that fragmented and complex regime when it comes to the gathering of evidence. It has been indicated that a new legislative act should be negotiated in order to establish a unified system for gathering of evidence. This new instrument should be based on the principle of mutual recognition. However, it should also enrich itself inspire itself on the flexibility provided for by the mutual legal assistance instruments. The Stockholm program in this particular point is now being implemented by the negotiations carried out by the council preparatory bodies on the basis of the new instrument, the proposal for a draft directive on European investigation order. I would like to present in more detail this new instrument to you in the third part of my presentation. The objective of the third part will be to counterbalance the two instruments which are the principal tools used by the practitioners, to be used by the practitioners in daily work when it comes to the gathering of evidence. That is, the framework decision on European evidence warrant and the directive on European investigation order. Let me start with the European evidence warrant framework decision. This instrument has been proposed by the Commission as early as in 2003. It has taken 5 years of rather intensive negotiations before it could eventually be adopted in December 2008. The European evidence warrant framework decision is based on the principle of mutual recognition. However, its scope is rather limited. That is, it only applies to the existing evidence, that being objects, documents or data. However, it is still expected that once fully implemented by the member state, it might provide an improvement to the existing situation. I need to point out that to this moment, the deadline of implementation, which has passed in January 2011, only 2 member states have completed their implementation process. What is European evidence warrant? European evidence warrant is a judicial decision issued by a competent authority in one member state, requiring another competent authority in another member state to collect specific evidence indicated in that evidence warrant. The competent authorities which are indicated as being allowed to issue European evidence warrant are judges, courts, investigative magistrates or public prosecutors. However, a specific validation procedure is also provided for cases where EEW would not be issued by judge, court or magistrate, investigative magistrate. Member states may require that such validation procedure be always completed by the issuing state in these particular situations. The European evidence warrant may be used for the following 4 types of proceedings. Criminal proceedings, which are brought or to be brought before a judicial authority for criminal offences under the national law of the issuing member state. Secondly, it may be used for proceedings brought by administrative authorities for acts that are punishable under the law of the issuing state and where the decision by the administrative authority may give rise to judicial proceedings. Thirdly, EEW may be issued for proceedings brought by judicial authorities for acts that are punishable under the law of the issuing state, where the decision may give rise to further court proceedings. And fourthly, EEW may be used for any of these 3 types of proceedings where it comes to the liability of legal persons. Now, the issuing state might ensure while sending out the European evidence warrant that the evidence which it requests is both necessary and proportionate for the proceedings. The EEW is transmitted directly between the competent authorities of the member states. And that is one of the significant improvements as against the mutual legal assistance. Well, the requests were transmitted via the central authorities and thus the whole process would take much more time. Linked to that is also an element included in the European evidence warrant, that is the setting up of a very clear deadlines, as short as 60 days, for the execution of that request. Another significant improvement in respect of the mutual legal assistance. Now, once transmitted to the executing member state, the European evidence warrant should be recognized and executed without any additional formalities being required by the executing member state. However, The issuing member state, issuing authority, may request the specific formalities and specific modalities of the execution be complied with by the executing authority. That possibility is given in order to ensure that greater admissibility of evidence once it is transmitted to the issuing member state. One of the main criticisms of the European evidence warrant is that the framework decision contains a rather extensive list of so-called grounds for refusal. And these possibilities include, in particular, the double criminality check or the territoriality clause. There are, of course, necessary safeguards concerning the fundamental rights of the persons who might be subject to the European evidence warrant. However, in general, a rather long list of grounds for refusal would not only complicate but might also slow down the process of the recognition and execution of the request made by the competent authority of the issuing member state. The European evidence warrant so far has not been implemented, and thus it's difficult to fully assess the advantages which are brought to the system of gathering of evidence across the EU member states. However, it has already at this stage been met with a certain criticism among the practitioners and academics. It is against that background and against the fact that European evidence warrant only to some limited extent sets out a mechanism of mutual recognition to the collection of evidence, remaining part being still governed by the mutual legal assistance, that has led a group of member states to the presentation in April of 2010 of a new instrument, a proposal for a directive on European investigation order. A draft directive on European investigation order has been presented, as I mentioned already, in April 2010 by seven member states, that being Belgium, Bulgaria, Estonia, Spain, Sweden, Austria and Slovenia. The negotiations have continued since during the Belgian, Hungarian and now Polish presidency. In June this year, in June 2011, a partial general approach has been reached on the general part of this instrument. The new proposal is drafted, as I mentioned already, in order to address the criticism which were put forward as against the European evidence warrant and the coexistence of mutual recognition and mutual legal assistance regimes. It is intended to replace all the existing instruments regarding the collection of evidence across the border and thus to put an end to the fragmented and complex regime which the practitioners are facing at this moment. In addition, the European investigation order should establish a single, efficient and flexible regime for practitioners for obtaining the evidence. The main changes which are introduced by the draft directive, and I have to underline here that this directive is still in the course of negotiations, so any remarks which are made here are only preliminary, are the following. First of all, the European investigation order should achieve a significant simplification of the procedure. It will become a single instrument covering all investigative measures for all types of evidence. Accordingly, the focus of the European investigation order is put on the investigative measure, as it has been the case for the mutual legal assistance, and not on the type of evidence, as was one of the main criticisms put against the European evidence warrant. The grounds for refusal, which are set out in Article 10 of the draft directive, have been also significantly limited. In addition, these grounds have been divided into three categories, depending on the coerciveness of a measure which is at stake. Finally, there are also very clear deadlines set out by the draft directive, which should further enhance the recognition and execution of requests. There are a number of practical improvements which are installed in the European investigation order. As it was the case for the European evidence warrant, all of them are intended to ensure a better admissibility of the evidence once it is transmitted to the issuing member state, as well as to allow the issuing member state to receive the evidence in the form and in the way it will be most useful for its criminal proceedings. The European investigation order should be transmitted directly between the competent authorities. The competent authorities have been established rather largely, as it was the case for the European evidence warrant, and as previously, a validation procedure has been foreseen for cases when the European investigation order be not issued by the judicial, strictly judicial authority. I would like to say now a few words about the scope of the directive, because that is one of the big steps forward also as far as the gathering of evidence is concerned. Now, the European investigation order, once adopted, and here these are obviously preliminary remarks since the negotiations are not completed yet, should cover within its scope all forms of investigative measures and all types of evidence. In other words, any evidential material may be requested by the issuing authority to be collected and subsequently transmitted by the executing authority. The AIO directive is divided currently into two parts. The first part, the so-called general part, on which the partial general approach has been already reached in June 2011, encompasses general provisions concerning the collection of evidence. This would be mainly linked to the deadlines, grounds for refusal, types of evidence, types of proceedings, or, for example, reason for postponement. The second part of the directive covers specific measures which have been selected by the decision of the negotiating member states because of their particular sensitivity. And it's also regarded as particular intrusiveness into the fundamental rights of the subjects of the investigative measure. These specific measures, which are included in the second part of the directive, are also governed by a specific regime. That specific regime of the second part obviously only complements the part, the general part, and the regime set out in the general part. I would like to give a few examples of the specific measures which are currently included in the draft directive. These are the monitoring on banking transactions, covert investigations, controlled deliveries, or interception of telecommunications. In the end, once the European Investigation Order Directive is adopted, of course the two parts will be complementary to each other, and so the system could operate as one unity. I would like to underline that this directive is still subject to negotiations by the experts within the Council preparatory bodies, and it shall shortly enter into process of co-decision of negotiations with the participation of the European Parliament. Only once that process is completed, the directive could be adopted. I would like to conclude this presentation by underlying once again the importance of the legislative activity of the EU in respect of gathering of evidence. Improvements to the current system, which were expected to be brought already by the 2000 MLA Convention, seems not to have really happened. The European evidence warrant has been met also with a certain level of criticism. This might lead me to a conclusion that probably only the adoption of the European Investigation Order will bring to the practitioners what they really need in order to efficiently continue carry out their criminal investigations and, in particular, to efficiently gather evidence across the EU. Thank you very much for your attention.